This session is how to detect that your domains are being abused for phishing by using DNS. And this room is South Pacific. And our two speakers are Arnold Hultzel and Carl Lovink.
Close.
So we don't have a lot of announcements, but the one that I do want to make sure of is that you put your phones on vibrate mode just so you don't interrupt the people around you. But otherwise, without further ado, please join me in giving a warm welcome to our speakers, Arnold and Carl.
Good afternoon. First of all, if you have any questions, please leave them at the end of this talk. We're happy to take any questions at the end. This talk is divided in three sections. First, we'd like to present a real-life phishing example. Then we present a number of standards. And finally, we present an implementation we have done, created on Splunk. But, however, you can also do this implementation based on the Elk Stack. Why do you think phishing is so important? Combating phishing is so important. First of all, the damage caused by the taxpayers and the businesses. Both of them are affected in their pockets and in emotional well-being. And in the Netherlands, we try to build a strong relationship between the taxpayers based on trust. We think that a good relationship is important to collect taxes in a sustained and improved way. And for that, it's very crucial to detect phishing attacks as soon as possible. The perpetrators are only interested in your and my money and credentials. The main objective of our research was trying to find a way to detect the phishing campaigns as soon as possible and break the money circles as quickly as possible. Here we present a real-life phishing example. Unfortunately, in Dutch, what it means is that the recipient received an email stated that he had to pay a tax installment of 83 euros. But look at the domain name. It said belastingdienst.nl. That's one of our domains. If we have implemented the standard at the moment the phishing mail was sent, we have could detect the phishing campaign instantly. And if both parties, sender and recipient, has implemented a lot of those standards, these phishing mail wouldn't even reach the inbox of the recipient. Before continuing, we like to have three different starting points to consider. First of all, there should not be an impact on the continuity of the business. It's not allowed to lose legitimate emails. Secondly, only standards may be used, as standards are defined in the RFCs. And finally, the techniques we present in this talk will only work if to prevent phishing if the sender and the recipient side has implemented these standards. For detection, that's not always true. A standard we are going to discuss today are shown on the slide. We are going to review a few existing security mechanisms so that we're all on the same page to understand what we did. These standards are designed because of the fact that the underlying protocols such as SMTP are insecure. Let's start with our first standard with StarTLS. StarTLS is a method of upgrading a plain text communication channel to a secure encrypted channel. With StarTLS, it's possible to create an encrypted SMTP connection between mail servers. However, there's a real issue with StarTLS. StarTLS is vulnerable for man-in-the-middle attacks. These man-in-the-middle attack issue can be mitigated by either using DANE or MTA-STS. Both standards we will present you in this talk. DANE can be seen as an alternative for PKI certificate authorities, and DANE builds on top of DNSSEC, so you have to implement DNSSEC. And DANE is a standard which allows you to securely associate an FQDN with an X509 certificate. And DANE makes a TLS connection less vulnerable for man-in-the-middle attacks. In the case of SMTP, the authoritative mail servers of a domain are stored in MX records. The X509 certificate of the mail server is also stored in the DNS zone file as a TLSA record. By comparing the X509 certificate used during the TLS negotiation with the one stored in the DNS zone file, the sending email server can detect a man-in-the-middle attack. Dane for SMTP solves the problem that TLS is fully optional with SMTP. Because of DNSSEC, self-signed certificates may be used. The Dutch Tax and Customs Administration, where we're working for, have two mail servers were authorized to send email. The TLS A record specified the protocol to publishing a TLS server certificate associations. In this case, there are two mail servers who were allowed or listening on port 25 TCP. The Dane TLS A record consists of four fields, the TLS A parameters. The first field is the certificate usage fields. In this case, type 3 means Dane EE, which means that the client doesn't have to check the whole X509 path. The second field is a selector field. Determined if the hash has been generated over the whole certificate or only on the public key. And the third field is the hashing algorithm that's been used. And finally, the last field is the public key as determined by the selector. Now I want to present a fairly new standard called MTA-STS. You can see MTS as a kind of HSTS for SMTP. MTA-STS is a mechanism to declare the ability to support TLS for SMTP and to specify whether sending mail servers must refuse to deliver an email to a server who doesn't support TLS. MTS solves the problem that TLS is fully optional with SMTP. With MTA-STS, DNSSEC is not required. So top-level domains who doesn't support DNSSEC can still use MTA-STS. A valid X509 certificate is required because the check with DNSSEC is not there. It's a huge difference because with Dane, you needed DNSSEC and you can use a self-signed certificate. The next standard is SMTP TLS reporting. It defines a reporting mechanism and the format by which mail servers can share information with the recipient domain about the TLS connection. The reporting scheme covers misconfiguration in your TLS configuration, DNS routing errors, etc. For both Dane and MTA-STS, the recipient domain can use this information to both detect unintentional misconfigurations, but also possible attacks like man-in-the-middle attacks. In order to implement DNSSEC, you have to add three DNS records to your DNS zone file, and you have to create a web page in a well-known directory of one of your web servers. The first DNS record points to the location where the MTS-STS policy file can be found. The second one, which starts with underscore MTI-STS, is important because there the policy ID can be found. The MTA-STS itself contains two fields. The V is MTS-STS-VA1, and the other one is the ID field. This field is used to track policy updates. The third one is about TLS reporting. Here you define the report of the email address where the report has to be sent to. You will receive the report in JSON format, which makes it easy to parse it in your log management tool or your SIEM. The MTA-STS policy file contains the MTA-STS policy and is distributed via HTTPS from the well-known directory. The policy file must be either in JSON or TXT format. MTA-STS policy is a set of key value pairs. Version is always STS-V1. And we have chosen test for the mode because it's a fairly new standard and the implementation grade at the moment is not very high. Google started in April, it was, Arnold?
April,
and we have implemented it somewhere in June. The MX key defined which mail servers are authorized to send email. And the MX age key defines the policy lifetime. This is an example of a good report. Here there is nothing wrong. So the report you receive in JSON format, and this is sent, the mail will be sent for an authorized mail server. And there was no issues with the certificate and the TLS session. The mail server, the sending mail server will produce the TLS report. In this case, there is something wrong. This could be a misconfiguration, or could be an active man-in-the-middle attack. These type of errors need more investigation. There are a number of result codes defined in the RFC, especially result codes like start TLS not supported and problems with the certificate are interesting result codes. These result codes can be an indication that somebody is performing a man-in-the-middle attack. The information gained from the TLS reports can help you to identify possible abuse of your mail infrastructure. Let's turn our attention now to sender policy framework. The sender policy framework is a method for email authentication and is designed to detect fraudulent mail server. SPF allows the mail server of the recipient to check that an email was sent by an authorized mail server. SPF is a robust and safe protocol. It's already an old protocol. Nevertheless, if you implement it incorrectly, your receiving mail server cannot query the DNS for a list of authorized mail servers, meaning that your domain can be abused for phishing attacks, and even worse, you will lose legitimate emails. Furthermore, it's possible to add macros to your SPF records. SPF had an advanced feature to use, which you can use to implement an advanced email track and trace systems like we did. This advanced feature of SPF is based on configuring macros in your SPF record. Unfortunately, this functionality is used very rarely on the internet, but it's very powerful. And that's why exactly why we're presenting this to you. According to research done by SPF All, only 13,000 domains of the 140 million domains have implemented macros in their SPF record. The implementation of SPF macros is described in the SPF RFC under paragraph 7.2 and Appendix A. And yes, sometimes it's very useful to read RFCs. Thank you, Arnold. He is our RFC fetishist. For the implementation we have done, it's very important that you have access to your DNS logs, request and response log. Arnold will present the implementation we have done. Macros in DNS can be used by wrapping them between delimiters. For SPF, there are a number of macros defined. The full list can be found in the SPF RFC. There's one important notice to make. If you're using %L or %S in your SPF record, the information will be stored in the resolver logs. %S and %L can contain valid email addresses. That means that could also be a cause of privacy issue. There is a work in progress to overcome this privacy issue. RFC 7816 is about DNS query name minimization of resolver logs. The RFC is published in March 2016. Implementation rate, however, is very low. So please ask your internet service provider to implement RFC 7816. Also be aware that if you use %L and %S in your DNS records, you have to create a DNS record for every valid email address. And if you have 100,000 email addresses, that will not work. And wildcards are also possible, but that will cause problems with DNSSEC. Let's go on how we have implemented SPF. First, we started it with like everybody with an SPF record, without macros. We have 6 mail servers. We are authorized to send email on behalf of the Dutch Tax and Customs Administration. An SPF record always starts with VSSPF1. The content of the MX tag is derived from the MX records in your DNS zone file. You can easily add extra mail servers by using the A tag. The minus all is vital. If you leave minus all out, that means that all mail servers on this planet can abuse your email domain. And do not forget add SPF records for your subdomains. If you do forget that, that means your subdomains can be abused. This is an example of our DNS SPF record with macros. First, we have created an SPF redirect record. We recommend this because from another management perspective, with the redirect modify, it's possible to share an SPF policy between multiple domains. So you have to make modifications on one place. The redirect modifier points to _SPF.belastingdienst.nl. Belastingdienst.nl is our domain. The SPF.belastingdienst.nl is a DNS record, is an SPF record with macros. In this case, the IP address, with the I, the O for the domain name, and the H for the hello string. Next, for each mail server, two A records has to be created with macros filled in. In our case, the mail server SMTP2.belastingdienst.nl had the IP address 85.195.159.108.15 and the hello string of SMTP2.belastingdienst.nl. And second one is needed because there are a number of mail servers who derive the hello string from the SMTP headers. And in that case, it's belastingdienst.nl. This is the mail flow in the CUT situation. Our mail server sends an email to the recipient. The DNS server will request an SPF record from at our DNS server, and he gets the SPF record back. Finally, you get the SPF record with macros. The mail server will expand that request for an A record with the macros filled in, with the IP address of smtp.belastingdienst.nl with any IP address. When that A record is found in the DNS zone file, you get an IP address back. Which IP address doesn't matter. You can put any IP address therein what you want. The receiving mail server should handle this as an SPF pass. That means that the mail server is authorized to send mail on behalf of the Dutch Tax and Customs Administration. In the case of a perpetrator sends an email on behalf of our domain, the same flow is executed as in the CUT situation. However, the I is then the IP address of the perpetrator, and the hello string is also the IP filled in by the hello string of the perpetrator. There will be no match in our DNS zone file, and the receiving mail server will get an NX domain back. Means that that mail server is not the mail server of the Dutch Tax and Customs Administration. The receiving mail server should handle this as an SPF fail. What you see here is that the whole phishing attack is handled completely outside our infrastructure. Normally, we haven't seen anything about this. But because we entered SPF macros, we can see that there is a mail sending on behalf of the Dutch Tax and Customs Administration to a recipient. And that mail was not sent by us. The next standard I will present is domain keys identified mail. DKIM is a method of detecting fraud sender email addresses in mails. The technique is often used by phishing attacks by forging the sender email address. And DKIM will sign the body and selected part of the SMTP header with a digital signature. The digital signature itself is transmitted in the DKIM signature header. Namespaces are available in the form of selectors. That means you can have multiple DKIM signatures. So if you have outsourced your email infrastructure to MailChimp or Message Labs, you can still use DKIM. The sender must use the secret key to sign the mail. And the receiver must use the public key to validate the digital signature. A DKIM record always starts with VS DKIM 1. And we use only one selector because we do not outsource our mail infrastructure. The KTAG is optional, and we use RSA, you can leave it out. In this case, we're using RSA. Finally, the PTAG contains the public key. It's encoded in Base64. DMARC is designed to detect against direct domain spoofing. DMARC policy allows the sender domain to indicate if the mails are protected by SPF and/or DKIM. Furthermore, it tells the recipient what to do if neither of those authentication methods passes. The DMARC policy also specifies how the mail server of the recipient can report to the sender of the domain about how the policy is executed at the recipient site. In the implementation we have done, we're using the reporting facility of DMARC heavily. A DMARC A record always starts with VSDMARC 1, and the policy domain is underscore DMARC. The DMARC policy has defined a number of tags, some of them required, some of them optional. The P tag defines the recommended action when both SPF and DKIM are failing. In our case, we recommend to reject the email. The SP tag does the same thing, but then for your subdomains. The RUA tag defines the email address where the DMARC feedback report can be sent to. You receive the feedback report always in XML format. But not all mail servers implement the RFC correctly. We have seen a number of feedback reports which doesn't conform the RFC standard. We have created a Python parser and which will be made available to you for free. The links will come up later in the presentation. There is also a rough tag. F stands for forensic, but be aware of using that because in the feedback you get back, there are parts or the whole. It could be also the whole part of the body could be sent to you in abuse reporting format. Now we've seen all the standards we use during our research, and we'd like to make a short summarization, but before I hand you over to Arnold. Implementation of these standards can be done. We have done it, and you can do it also. And if you have any questions, you can reach out to us. And both sender as recipients has to implement these standards if you want to prevent phishing mail. We are convinced that if everybody implement these standards, there will be a lot less phishing in the world. So go talk to your internet service providers and convince them to implement these standards. And the same is for your mail providers. And yes, there are ways to avoid broken mailing lists and forwarding issues. In the Netherlands, we reach out to our internet service providers and urge them to configure these standards and to use them. In government organizations in the Netherlands, has to comply to a number of standards. And these standards are defined in the Dutch standardization platform Comply or Explain list. SRDN, who is the registered organization for NL, the NL top-level domain, announcing financial incentive. If a register implements DMARC and start TLS, they get a discount on foreign domain name. DMARC gives a discount of 16 cents, start TLS of 4 cents, and the wholesale price of an NL domain is €3.40 per year. This concludes my part of the talk. Thank you for your attention so far, and I'd like to hand over to Arnold now. He will discuss the implementation we have done.
Yes, thank you. I know I'm between you and beer, so I will try to wrap it up. When we implemented all these different standards, we gained a lot of information. We gained a lot of more insight about what was happening. And, well, we wanted to do something with it. With DMARC, we get more insight in what is happening on the receiving part of the email chain, and with the SPF, we get more insight in what's happening on the sending part of the mail chain. We wanted to do something with that information, but we didn't want another tool to roll out or whatever, so We wanted to use what we already had. We had Splunk, so I created a Splunk app. But if you have Elastic or whatever, go with that. Like I said, I created the Splunk app and I did some reporting in it. First, the DMARC reporting. Those are delivered via email, as you stated in your DMARC record. And those emails contain an XML file or an XMLGZ file that is the actual report. I created a Python script to parse out those XML files and to cope with a lot of bad implementations. And then that script parses out a logging that can be either in key value pairs or in JSON. It will write it to a log file and then you can pick it up with, well, Splunk or Elastic or whatever. What you need to have to do this is, well, obviously a DMARC record. You need network access for the Python script to the mailbox that is receiving the DMARC emails. It can be either via POP or via IMAP. The user ID and the password for that mailbox, and, well, Splunk or Elastic for the dashboarding and to gain more information. This is one of the dashboards that I've created to get more insight. On the top row, you see the policy as we have them in the DNS. We have a reject policy now for DMARC, but please don't start with that because you will lose a lot of mail. Start with a none policy, as in don't do anything with the mail, just process it, so you get more information about what's happening and you can work on that. See where your mail is coming from, what's done with it, and whatnot. The boat relaxed that's standing there has to do with the alignment of your emails, if they may come from subdomains or not. What we can do here is group all the emails on a couple of fields. You can group them by whether or not they came from one of your servers, whether or not the DKIM or SPF alignment and results, what that was, what the header from was from the mail address, a couple of things. What you see here is grouping by what happened to the mail, whether they were whether they were delivered or whether they were rejected. The bottom layer gives you more information about the IP address that was sending the mail, what the alignment was, that's the first green column of your DKIM, how your SPF was handled, and the last two greens are what was done with those emails, in this case they were delivered, and whether or not that was confirmed the policy that you stated. Everything is okay here. We sometimes see that everything is aligned and everything is okay, but they're still rejected. That's probably because some people don't want email from the tax office. Don't know why, but okay. Created another dashboard that's more of a management dashboard. I mean, we have a big video wall at our SOC. And yeah, sometimes management comes in and they want to see these kind of reports. To us, we don't really actually use it, but if you have a big mail environment with your mail system spread out across different countries or different continents, this can be a nice dashboard to see how the mails are balanced between different countries. If you see a green dot, it's okay, the mail is coming from your servers. If it is a red dot, it's coming from someone else. I've here focused on Europe because we're based in the Netherlands, but if you zoom out, you see more red dots across both sides of Europe. So to the left and to the right, people are abusing it. Then the biggest thing, SPF. Like Carl told, we changed our SPF record with macros so we can get more insight information about where the emails are coming from. What you need is an SPF record with macros. You don't have to do it all. The I is very useful because it gives you the IP address of the sending system. Another thing to have is DNS query logging enabled on your DNS server. By default, it's mostly off. So enable it, put those DNS logs in your Splunk system or your Elasticsearch system or whatever. Another important thing to have is to know what the good queries are. So what are legitimate queries that can be done? That is to rule them out and only see what's wrong, because those are the most interesting queries. If we dashboard it, we have something like this. This is all good. This is what we like to see. It's all green. What you see here is in the first column, it's the IP address of the sending server, and those are our mail servers. The second one is the halo of that server, and then the domain that is sending. You see whether or not it is a system that is in your SPF record, and what the response was. We also have the querying IPs here, and the number of hits it is. It's okay. What we also saw in the beginning was a lot of these. Those are badly configured mail servers. They have implemented SPF not in the right manner. So we have a wrong halo here. It's either unknown or it's set to localhost or whatever. So they're filling out the macro, the H macro, with the wrong information. They do a query for that and they get an NX domain back. So if they only rely on SPF, these mails will fail. But it wasn't that much and we could contact those people or we were contacted with, we can't receive any email of you, blah, blah. And they fixed it. And it's mostly some, well, or outdated version of a mail server or some very niche mail server that, well, it's not being used very much. This is what we also saw. And this was bad. When we first started with the implementation of the new SPF record with the macros, this came up. This domain here, it's loopbaanlab.info. It is a domain of the Dutch Tax and Customs Office, but it is a park domain. It has been used once for a campaign, and then, well, we don't give back any domains. If we once registered, we always have them, but it is parked. What we see here are a lot of IP addresses that aren't our IP addresses. Those are mostly customer IP addresses of some routers or some IoT devices. I've looked a couple of them up in Shodan. You can have a field day with them. The halo that's been provided is a fake one. The Yandex.net is a legitimate mail domain from a Russian company, but those forward number, blah, 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 those didn't exist at the time that it was seen in our logins. The receiving mail servers, well, those are mostly Mail.ru, Mail.ru, the Russian mail company. Normally, without the SPF records, we would have never seen this, because the IP addresses on the left side aren't ours. Those aren't our sending servers. The receiving part, we aren't either. The only thing that is ours is the domain that's being abused. These mails probably went through, because at the time that we started with this, we weren't aware of the fact that you need to have a SPF record for your non-existing subdomains. So you need a wildcard record so that there will always be a response on your SPF query. There will always, then you get always get a minus all response. Fun part was that within a couple of weeks, max a month, after we installed the new SPF records, this was all gone. We have seen nothing about this anymore. So I think it's because, well, the mails weren't coming through, or the persons that did this weren't interested anymore. As I said, I created a Splunk app with a couple of things, so it can be used by more people. You can use the knowledge that we gained and go with that. So you don't have to reinvent the wheel, so to speak. I have some more things in there. I have created some dashboards with RFC information because, well, I was reading it and working on it, then thought, how was that again? Rereading the RFC, working on it, rereading the RFC, and I got tired of that, so I wrote down the most important bits and thought, well, might be useful for others. It's about the SPF RFC and the DMARC RFC, and I have put down the most important things, in my eyes, in there, and also to explain a little bit from what's in the RFC and how I've implemented it in the app. I'm working on a couple of other dashboards, like the number of queries per record type. I will show you later. And I have created a dashboard, more like a wizard for you, so that you can easily create those DNS records that are required. So you can do it correct the first time. I'm working on this dashboard. It's more of an adoption overview. What we've done is say, well, let's say that every query of SPF is like, let's state SPF is set to 100%. Then for every 100 SPF queries that we get for a record, we get about 50, 51, 52 queries for our DKIM record. And for every 100 SPF queries that we get only 37 DMARC requests. So this is to show how your customers are adopting the standards. And, well, as the Dutch Tax Office, we have a lot of customers, whether they like it or not. But the adoption rate of those people, of those customers, of those citizens that are using like Gmail or Outlook, or companies that have their own environment, this is the adoption rate. And research shows that this is very, very high, but I still think it's a bit on the low side. The dashboard on how to create those records. It starts with an explanation of what it is. I created it because, well, we needed a lot of records, and you can't just go to the DNS guys, to the network guys, and say, please create a valid SPF record for me. You need to provide them with something. And yeah, it can be tedious, it can be difficult, it can be a lot. So you just have to fill out a couple of fields, and it will spit out the records that you need to create. So I've done this with the previously abused domain, the lobanlab.info. I filled out everything. I don't know, can I? Yeah, I can. Yeah, here's the lobanlab. I filled out the information for the DMARC. We want the reject policy, and we want the RUA mails being sent to our central mailbox. This is an important thing because this requires you to create an additional record, which is most of the times forgotten. Am I back? Yeah, I'm back. I wanted an advanced SPF. I wanted it to redirect to our central SPF record. We have one SPF record for all our domains. It's about 550 domains that we have. And we want one SPF record. Sorry. Because, well, administratively, that's more easy. And then this is what we need for our parked domain. We just needed four DNS records. The first one, the wildcard, with just an SPF minus all, so nothing can be sent from there. We have a DMARC record that says, well, reject policy and send all the emails to rua@blastingnews.nl. We have on our main domain, we have the redirect record for the SPF, for the central SPF record. And then this one, which is quite long, is for the DMARC reporting. The last one, 99 out of 100 cases, this is forgotten. And then you don't receive any Rua emails. So you think everything is fine, no one is sending mail. But as a matter of fact, there might be sending mail, you just don't get the records. This is done, and it is stated in the RFC, and I've put a note on everything as to why is that record. It is stated in the RFC section 7.1 that you need to create this record to prevent a DOS attack. Because otherwise, someone could just register a domain, say all the Rua reports need to go to that other domain, then send out a buckload of emails to a whole lot of different companies, and then you will get bombarded with Rua emails. And they can get quite big. So to prevent that kind of a DOS attack, you need to have this additional record. Also done that for our main domain, and well, we needed to create a lot more records, but this is just a one-time event. You just need to create those records at one time, and then you're safe. Well, safer. This is for all our mail servers. We needed to create two records, like Carl already told you, one with just the domain and one with the actual halo of the system. We have six mail servers, so that was a couple of records. Actually, we needed one additional, so we needed 15 records, one for the underscore SPF, where the actual policy was. So this gave us a lot of insight, especially the advanced SPF records. We got so much fun information with it, and yeah, it was great. Of course, there were some lessons learned. You need to be aware of your mail environment. And it happens. I've been to a couple of other governmental institutes, and they have a marketing department or a communications department, and they use different mail servers because they use MailChimp. If you implement these records and do not know that, and all the mails that they send out will just go down the drain. And then you get annoying people on the phone. Why are the mails not coming in? So that's. Monitor your mailing logs from your mail system, because there's valuable information in there about why emails didn't make it. Because the receiving party will give you some feedback as to it was because SPF failed or DMARC failed or some other general error message. Test your policies. And test them on domains that you know are not being used for email. So you can set a strict policy, see what happens, see what feedback you get. That must be, unfortunately, you need to test in production. But yeah, it keeps you sharp. Don't forget an SPF record, a wildcard SPF record for your non-existent domains. Otherwise, well, there is no SPF policy, so all the mails that have been sent from non-existing domains will go through. I created an app, put it on GitHub for everybody to use and abuse or do your thing with it, learn from it. If you find anything wrong, do a pull request and whatever. Final thoughts, and then it's almost beer time. You can get more info, even if you have nothing to do with the email, like I showed before. You're not the sending party, you're not the receiving party, you're just being the abused party. You can get that info. Work closely together with your email guys and girls, or non-gender specific persons. So make sure that the MTA administrators, that the SOC analysts, and the network guys that control the DNS work close together, so you can get this done. We've done it on 550 domains, so it can be done. And just please use the standards described in the RFCs. I've been through a couple of RFCs, and I've been through, so that's the theory, and I've been to what's actually happening, and there's a gap, unfortunately. Just a resource overview that we've used with all the RFCs, with the Splunk app, with the SPF statistics, a DMARC adoption report, which is quite interesting. Out of 21,000 domains that were tested, only 2% had a reject policy. So that's quite low. And that's about it. If you have any questions at all, please come forward so the rest can go drink beer, or just all go drink beer and we join you.